So thank you, Essam, for the introduction. And I'd like to thank also the department at one time for inviting me for this lecture.
My pleasure.
This is about an approach to ship design that has been developed in the project HOLISHIP, a European-funded project. And some very short information about this project. This was a quite large scale research and development project that ended in December last year. It ran over 4 years. And it was carried out by representatives from the whole European maritime industry and scientific community. Actually, more than 40 representatives of the European maritime industry participated in this project. The project was coordinated by HSVA Hamburg. Project manager was Dr. Jochen Marzi. And I was the scientific advisor of this project. So you see here the profile of the project in terms of participants. Among them also at least three Norwegian companies, DNVGL, Marine Tech, that is next to you, and Kongsberg, with very significant contributions to this project. But of course, nobody is missing here. Actually, when we proposed this project, we merged the efforts of three groups that were independently developed. And finally, we came to this huge project that was indeed not trivial to coordinate, but finally the outcome was very successful, I think. Now, what is the HOLISHIP approach to ship design and the holistic approach to ship design? In terms of mathematics, it is the parametric, multi-objective, and multidisciplinary optimization of maritime products for life cycle, of course, applied to the maritime field. And the application in the project was to ships and offshore platforms. But of course, the method is very general, the holistic approach to design. But you may know that a holistic approach, even to problems in society, in medicine, or many other disciplines, is possible. In any case, we addressed the problem of ship design here as a parametric, multi-objective, and multidisciplinary optimization problem. And about this, I will talk to you. The HOLISHIP approach includes not only the multi-objective optimization, but also virtual reality product modeling and virtual prototyping. We have demonstrated that, and also enables multi-site cloud working. That means remote working and collaboration from remote places through satellite communication. There are a series of references to this project. The first one is a publication by myself that was published more than 10 years ago in the journal Computer Design. At that time, actually, I formulated this holistic approach to ship design and to ship design optimization. And I'm very happy, actually, to see that out of that, we had a very big project with very tangible results. The most recent publication about the outcome of the project is this Journal of Ship Research publication that appeared online in December last year. And in print, there is always delay, but it will be there in the course of this year. And very important, We have developed also a book, a multi-authored book, a holistic approach to ship design that was published by Springer. In volume one, there was a description of the methods and tools that we developed. And in the volume two that appeared just in June last this year, we have the application case study. That means how the participants of the project applied this method to a variety of application cases. You can find that on the internet, and I don't need to say more about that. Now, how was the evolution of this holistic approach to ship design? And this is, of course, related to my personal experience in this. This was actually a bottom-up systemic approach. Although, of course, some central idea was there, and you could say simultaneously in my head was also a top-down approach. But we started actually with the objectives by doing studies for specific attributes of the ship, like risk-based design, design of safe for safety, design for operation, design for life cycle, design for efficiency, design for zero emissions in recent time. And in order to do that, there were a series of tools developed over the years, actually in the last 20 years. Some of them became available earlier and some of them lately. Regarding the parametric design, that is very important. We used well-known software platforms, CASES of Friendship Systems and NAPA. Whereas for parametric design and virtual modeling, in the project we used the RCE, CPACS platform of Deutsche Luft- und Raumfahrt, that is the German aerospace industry, that has developed a framework for design of aircraft. And this was applied here to maritime products. And I will briefly report also about this. Now, with these tools developed, we could go, and I forgot to say that, of course, multi-objective optimization algorithms are available now for many years, and they were also heavily employed in this procedure. So the development that started in the late 80s was from bottom, from the objectives, having the tools and going up. And with respect to this timeline, okay, some of these problems are easier to solve. And I don't like to say that we started with risk-based design, but of course we did design for safety and risk-based design in early 90s, middle 90s, after the accident of Estonia. A lot of research was in this area, also funded by the EU, and we benefit out of this and have demonstrated that this parametric design with respect to risk-based assessment is possible, and later it was extended also to other properties. Now, I will try in the following just to compare the traditional approach and this new approach that we call design synthesis. Everybody knows the design spiral that was introduced by Professor Evans in the late 50s, in which we have the mission requirements, the specification by the ship owner, and then out of this we go to the estimation of the main proportions of the vessel, develop the body plan, hydrostatics, and so on. We do this loop. So the first loop is the concept design, and going to the detailed design. We need also to put more effort in order to come to a detailed design. And you see here some man-month effort, of course, referring to the 50s or 60s, where a lot of work was done manually. Nowadays, this man-month effort is, you can divide that sometimes by a factor 20, I would say. Not 20, maybe 15, but in any case, What is important is that if you go from concept design to detailed design, the effort is increasing by a factor between 12 and 17. And this you need to take care when properly planning a design and the delivery of the ship. All this, of course, if you develop a new ship design concept, not starting from a certain parent design that you modify, then the effort is less. But in any case, what is the difference now? The difference is that we do the design synthesis. That means we take all the steps that are necessary for ship design, and we do a parallel processing of this by certain procedures. And going deeper, we come to the detailed design. This was demonstrated in the HOLISHIP project. And we have to say that a lot of these procedures are automated, automated because they are programmed by macros, or semi-automated. This enables the parallel processing and, of course, much quicker design results, besides other positive outcomes that I will comment in the following. And now, a few words about optimization. I like this reference because it refers also to my former professor, Novaki, who introduced ship design optimization as an optimization problem with constraints by some presentation at the SNAMES annual convention 1970. It was about the preliminary design of a tanker, the initial sizing, and the objective was to minimize the required freight rate, a classical problem of ship design. And he described the optimization as a decision support, problem, decision process, in which we have some design variables and parameters, some merit functions that we need to assess, constraints to consider. Out of this original idea, I developed later this this kind of chart that is much more generic, although the main attributes are there. What we have here, on the input side, we have, again, the owner requirements, maybe the information about a barn hull, if parent design, if it is there. In any case, some request for deadweight or payload capacity for a cargo ship, or for a mission, if it is not a cargo ship, the speed, maximum draft, some initial arrangement, and so on. Now, important is here this. So the design parameters that may have been given in as individual numbers for certain parameters, they are here given as a parametric model of ship geometry and outfitting. That means we have a parametric description of the ship, its geometry, its hull form, the arrangement of spaces go with it, the arrangement of main outfitting, for example, the engine or bridge, main living spaces, the structural arrangements, and maybe also network arrangements and so on. That can be, this list can be very large depending on the developed parametric model. This is not trivial, of course. And I will show you later. This is not a digital twin, it is a way to digital cloning that is more than twin. It is digital siblings, what we generate there. Then we have a variety of constraints to consider that are the constraints are set by society, regulations, maybe market demand and supply constraints, the cost of major materials, and maybe other case dependent constraints. And now we come to the optimization criteria. Okay, originally we did optimize for the least resistance or the least powering or the best seakeeping. But here the indicators are more complex. We say maximization of some performance efficiency indicators. that can be have many of these attributes. The minimization of the environmental impact indicators, minimization of building and operational cost, the maximization of the investment profit, in any case, or even minimization of the investment risk, all these that can be formulated by some mathematical models can be included as an objective function in the frame of a multi-objective optimization. So here you see an implementation of this multi-objective optimization in the cases system or friendship system for a ROPAX ship, in which we have a parametric model for the hull form developed by in the cases framework. And this information then is transferred to software tools for the calculation of wave resistance, for example, by a potential theory code, Michel of HSVA, or a CFD code by Fresco of HSVA. Sea keeping, intact and damage stability is done here by NAPA, that is also connected to the cases platform. Communicating and exchanging information as necessary. The steel weight and structural design is here by BV Mars, Bureau Veritas Mars software. We have demonstrated that also it is possible to do that by NAPA steel in more recent applications. And we have individual software tools for the CAPEX and OPEX and for the arrangements. So all these, of course, they have to follow a certain series and steps, but it is enabled by parallel processing to a great extent by use of specific models, surrogate models that I will introduce shortly after. Now, one more of the outcome of the HOLISHIP project is this virtual prototyping, actually the demonstration of the performance of two alternative radars and the effect on the maneuverability for a cargo ship. This was demonstrated on the bridge simulator of Marin. And an experienced captain could drive navigate the two alternative designs and see the performance, so that we had also some human feedback for this. This was realized in the RC environment, software environment of DLR, and the marinized version of CPAX, that is this parametric aircraft configuration scheme of DLR, but HOLISPEC is the marine version of CPAX. That was developed by Marin and Associates Netherlands. Even more, thanks to this remote component environment of RCE and its interaction with cases, we could demonstrate that working from different places. Here in Hamburg, we had DLR and DRCE. Potsdam is Friendship Systems, Athens and DUA, and Wageningen is Marin. Then we could work on a common project and exchange data and actually enable this remote working, working on the same project. And maybe this will be more developed and demonstrated in the future. Something new for the maritime area. We had in the HOLISHIP project 9 demonstrators. As you can see, an offshore support vessel developed by Kongsberg Maritime, a ROPAX vessel developed by Tritech, a research vessel developed by Fincantieri, a multi-purpose ocean vessel developed by our French colleagues in Naval Group, a merchant vessel operation by Danaos and TNTUA, offshore platform that was by offshore platform was by Elomatic in Finland. That is an offshore platform for Arctic waters. And I have to make a correction here. The PAX here was developed by Meyerwerft. Sorry, it was a lightweight issues of cruise ships. And these robots were developed by Tritech, and double-ended ferry was developed by Elomatic. So for these nine applications, we had demonstrations of concept design, contract design, and virtual testing in two cases. And actually, details of all this you can find in this volume two of the book that is authored by representatives of all these companies that I, not universities, these are, they are well supported by universities. And I'm very happy to see that, that the industry is using this approach successfully and developing innovative products. Of course, I had this question sometimes, and when you introduce something new, you get some responses. We have been always doing this. I mean, what is new there? So I thought to make a direct comparison between conventional and the HOLISHIP approach and point out the differences point by point. So the first issue is the concept design. So the concept design traditionally, it is an empirical approach. Of course, it is supported by available computer-aided calculator and graphics processing procedures. But what a designer is doing is the generation of one to three designs, and then intuitively, or maybe also mathematically, selecting the most promising variant for going to the next step, to the preliminary design. In our approach, we have the automated parametric generation of hundreds of variants. It can be also thousands of variants, but this is not a problem. This is what I call the digital siblings, namely some parametric description of the hull form, and as I said, also subdivision and so on, so that by changing some parameters, you can have the generation of hundreds of design that you can evaluate. And pay attention, this is one class above digital twin. So you can compare these variants with a baseline design and properties, and have first in the concept design a global optimization. That means find the most promising variants already in concept design. For example, here we have the attributes that we are looking at is are the attained subdivision index. That is an index that showing the sufficiency of damage stability. And depicted is here the attained index margin. That means how much this attained index is above the requested or below. So the designs that are positive, the blue ones are feasible and the other ones are unfeasible. So you can see here for hundreds of designs, some variation with respect to the beam and the length of the ship. It trivially, of course, when you increase the beam of the vessel, then you get a better attained index. But of course, increasing the beam, you have some other disadvantages, as you may know. So even having a longer ship, at least for this index, not always pay off. And I have here another diagram showing the net present value as a function of the attained index margin. By the way, here is the initial design, I think this one. And you can see a very nice Pareto front here out of the hundreds of designs. You can go and say, okay, the required index is here. If I go a little bit more to be safer, then I have several designs that are better than the original one. Of course, if you go to have a much safer ship, then the net present value drops down, and even it can become negative for very variance. So let's go now to the preliminary design after the concept design and the conventional approach. We are going to sequentially do the optimization with respect to hydrodynamics, structures, machinery selection, economics, and so on, of just few design variables. So in our case, of course, because we would have a parametric model, this is possible for hundreds of variants. So, you see here that concept design and preliminary design is going into one into the other. The local optimization, of course, can go also, say, here to the stern of the vessel, where you like also to optimize propulsion specifically. And we have done it in another project. By the way, this project is also Norwegian, the Tram project, that is developing a fast zero emissions catamaran, battery driven catamaran, and this is presently under construction in Fjellstrand shipyard, not far from Trondheim. So we can have this local optimization by CFD tools, of course, in this case, and find the optimal propulsion arrangement for this. And coming now to the accuracy of the calculation methods, this is another basic difference. Whereas in the conventional approach, then we are in the concept design, we use mostly empirical models. Whereas going to contract design, we use more advanced methods, like say for resistance, we may use a Holtrop method for the concept design, but when we go to contract design, we need to use CFD. Here we can go to very high accuracy already, already in the concept design, namely by use of surrogate models. And this I need to explain how this is done. By the way, this is an application by Elomatic and HSVA for the design of a double-ended ferry. And it shows the change of resistance over length and beam and some 3D surface here. That is the result of CFD calculations. Initially, maybe also by potential theory code, new shallow by HSVA. But in any case, what we do is to do a design of experiments, parametric variation of the hull, calculate for these variants the resistance, and then having out of that a certain, an empirical model, a surrogate model that fully replaces the individual CFD calculations. And of course, using this surrogate model, it takes the same like using Holtrop method, and not only for one variant, but for hundreds of variants, and of course, at very high accuracy. And this we can use already a concept design if necessary. Thus, going now to design lead time and the person man efforts. The comparison is there also straightforward. If we have a parent design, a baseline design, and it is often so, of course, the concept design will take only some person days in the traditional approach, depending on the experience of the design team. And going to the contract design, we need several person months. And if no baseline design is available and we need to collect information, of course, this effort is multiplied. In this approach, if we have available suitable parametric models from a previous design campaign, then the concept and contact design is maybe done in much shorter lead times. I think the comparison in terms of effort between conventional and this approach is more than five. Depends also on the stage of design. And some other issue here is that we can have smaller design teams working and with less experience. Of course, always some experienced designers must be there, but you don't need to have larger groups because a lot of experience, of course, has been already programmed in the parametric models, and the information that is there is available for deciding. Of course, all these big advantage, we need to consider that if no parametric model is there, that means you develop a new design, you will need several days or even weeks for building up a robust and meaningful parametric model. And this greatly depends on the modeler's experience. I think in the future we'll have more modelers of designs. They need to have good experience both in ship design, but also in programming, in developing that. But once you have the parametric model, I think you have solved a major issue of the ship design problem. The effect of cost in the conventional approach, again, we check the cost for some variants. What is here, we have, of course, we check the effect of hundreds of design variants on the cost, and I have shown you this earlier, both with respect to CapEx and OpEx and NPV and so on. This is coming inherently with these parametric models. The quality of design is, of course, superior by this approach because we have here a consolidated standard design documentation that comes together with the parametric modeling and all the processing information out of that. And of course, we have a better quality because we have compared the performance of hundreds of designs. And the quality assurance is also because the assessment of these variants is done on the basis of rational criteria. It is not done intuitively. At the end, of course, always the designer will have the decision, but he has on his table a lot of indicators to take the final decision. Safety of ship and marine environment, traditional approach, rules-based design, that is well known to all those working on stability, damage stability. And we know that fulfilling these rules, we don't know yet the safety level of the design that is approved by the regulations. It is a design that fulfills the regulations that are mostly empirical. However, with the introduction of risk-based design, that is also now in the new rules, the probabilistic assessment of damage stability, for example, we can do a lot of things. And here I have some slides from an earlier project, the project GOLDS, goal-based damage stability. This is the optimization of a ROPAX vessel with respect to the potential loss of life, PLL. And what we can see here is the GCAF is the gross cost for averting fatalities. That means how much money, this is in million of dollars for a specific ship, large ship, you need to invest in order to reduce the potential loss of life, the probability that because of sinking of the ship, some lives could be lost. The initial design here is here. We have a PLL of 3.91. And we can see in these optimization graphs that there are a lot of designs for which we can go from 3.91 to 2.6, for example, reducing the potential loss of life by maybe about 60% by an investment of maybe about $5 million. And there are a lot of designs much better than this one that are even, you see here, the gross cost of averting fatality is negative. That means the ship is less expensive than the original one. So, of course, in order to understand this PLL, you need to be some specialist in demi stability. But very simply, I can tell you that this means that if you take, say, all the RoPax ships that are operating over their life cycle and take the accidents and take the lost lives and distribute them to all the ships, then this will be what is assigned to this individual design that we're assessing. In any case, it is an indicator that it tells you how good is your design. And it is very important also in the maritime industry to have this kind of indicators and not some fuzzy empirical safety rules that do not tell you what means to fulfill these rules. So energy efficiency, we did in recent time a lot of studies on this, also in the HOLISHIP project. It is very important that in the HOLISHIP approach, we could do this kind of optimization at early design stage. And you will see in our HOLISHIP applications, many studies dealing with that, many applications run by the industry did this kind of conceptual design studies, namely to find the optimal machinery arrangement for a specific design that is for least energy and least environmental impact, considering also the EDI regulations and so on. So life cycle performance and assessment, this comes next. This is something also that we're greatly promoting in the HOLISHIP project. And this refers not only to the economics, but also the environmental impact. So we have developed indicators for this and they are optimized already at early design stage. Whereas in the conventional approach, we try to meet the targets of IMO and certain requirements. Innovations in ship design, this is a difficult subject to discuss. Of course, in the conventional approach, limited because the lack of baseline designs to build upon, and somebody must have the idea and promote it. In the parametric design, you have more possibilities in that because practically you do a first principles simulation-based ship design approach. But the main problem is how to define the parametric model. I mean, how to transfer the innovation idea to a mathematical model. And there, the developers of parametric models need to spend some time develop this idea. It is something that we need to work more on this. I think there are also mathematical models specifically working on this. And we may come at some time later to discuss this again. Software platforms. Of course, in the conventional approach nowadays, designers, shipyards, they have professional naval architectural software platforms, but they have limited or no collaboration with external software tools. That means you have the platform, you work with the platform, you can do a lot of things. But if you like to run a software from outside, then you need to consider strict communication protocols if this communication is possible at all. In our case, we have flexible software platforms with simple communication protocols. and a long list of software tools have been already integrated into this. Here you see some example for the communication of cases with NAPA. In NAPA, we do the damage stability, especially also the intact stability, because NAPA is considered as an accepted industry standard in that respect. CASES is a framework, not a naval architectural software platform. And we can transfer and process then the results of NAPA by CASES. And here is a more recent application of CASES in connection with NAPA Steel, no? Some development by Hochschule Bremen. And you see here that development of a series of macros that out of the RAL form and the initial arrangement, we can develop some structural design that is, as I said, parametric. It's very important to understand it. That means the sizing, the thickness of the plates, and so on is varied so that we can really optimize after that. Design workflows in the empirical approach, in general, it is a manual planning of the design workflow. Some experienced designer is dictating the steps. And there is a limited coded design workflow procedures. In the HOLISHIP approach, we have the coding of design workflow procedures by macros. And this was demonstrated in several of the application cases that we have developed in HOLISHIP. And still a lot of work needs to be done there, because in order to develop these design workflow procedures, we need to have both a good designer in hand and somebody well-known, well-knowledgeable in the platforms where these macros are programmed. Distributed working, cloud communication. I wrote here not known in ship design, in the conventional approach. We have demonstrated that in the HOLISHIP project. The same applies to virtual prototyping. That is something coming up. I mean, it was here demonstrated for the performance of two alternative radars by Marin, but a lot of things need still to be done in the future, in this virtual prototyping, the maritime sector. And I think also research work in this area will be also funded by the European Commission. And finally, not trivial, but it is trivial that the acceptance by the industry of this approach is not trivial. It's something new. Of course, we had participating in the HOLISHIP, I would say all the major European shipbuilding industry and knowledgeable academia. And there will be growing acceptance of this in the future by naval architects. But I think very important also is the HOLISHIP book and dissemination through the partnership and education. My idea when I proposed this concept of HOLISHIP book was that this kind of approach needs now to be taught in graduate courses. And only if young engineers are educated in this area, they will be able then also to apply that widely in the maritime industry. It is difficult to say to somebody working for many years in the industry to replace some procedures that he knows they are working well for him by something new that he cannot entirely understand. So I come now to a conclusion, a summary, and some concluding remarks. These are the main issues that we discuss: design synthesis, integration of software tools, parametric multi-objective design optimization, flexible communication of tools, growth of synthesis models, replacement of resource-intensive simulations with surrogate models via modeling, distributed working enabled by RC cloud computing, and the HOLISHIP approach to ship design was proven in a series of application studies, including human factors, as we got some feedback by virtual modeling and VR testing. So closing, I like to acknowledge that the HOLISHIP was the outcome of the joint effort of more than 40 representatives of the maritime industry and research community. I think more than 100 engineers maybe worked in this area, if not more. And to acknowledge also the funding by the European community. Thank you. And last slide, something philosophical. The HOLISHIP was introduced by Aristotle's metaphysics, saying that the whole is more than the sum of the parts. And this is practically the essence of this approach. Namely, you cannot optimize by optimizing the parts. You need to see the whole in order to find the optimum of the whole. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Apostolos, for very nice presentations. And anyone has question, just raise hand, and I would give him the opportunity to ask the question, and you can also ask your question in the chat.
Yeah. I'll stop share. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And just a question from me for who, for the people who are interested to having access to NOPA or cases, and how can they contact you? And for example, we have people here from industry, so students and professors. How would be how they can get access to cases and also NOPA?
Well, NOPA is a large software package. Many universities, actually, they have licenses, educational licenses. Mm-hmm. Also, NTUA has a series of licenses, and I'm not sure. I think NTNU should also have license of NAPA. I can assume educational licenses. And the same applies to the cases. PS platform, you can, if your department doesn't have a license for that, I think you can contact Stefan Harriers, who is the director of Friendship Systems, and he will be able, I think in educational licenses, they do not cost much, sometimes free of charge, but I cannot tell you whether how he will offer that. And there are also training courses for this. Of course, you need to gradually be introduced into that, solve some simpler problems, and then come to more advanced problems like ship design. And ship design is a very complex process that has a lot of issues from hydrodynamics, stability, structures, everything is there. The first thing is, of course, also to understand this parametrization, I think. The parametrization means that you have some parent and you do a cloning. No? That is why I said the siblings. No? As soon as you have this parametric model, you can develop hundreds of variants by changing the dimensions and so on. The next step is how to assess these variants. Because if you do for all these variants, hundreds of CFD calculations, right, it takes very long. you need some things to do up front independently. And for this reason, I think it is good to learn about surrogate models. What means surrogate model? A surrogate model is a surrogate for the exact model. No? That is something that is used in many disciplines, many sciences, and came lately to maritime. Okay, yeah. Maybe yes. Some question was in there.
Yeah, yeah. There's a question that how can we say about the accuracy of surrogate predictions in comparison with high fidelity model?
Yeah, it is actually, I cannot quickly now show you some chart, but you find this in the publications, okay? But the accuracy depends on what model you are testing. We have tested that for resistance and eddy resistance in waves, for example. That means we have compared the surrogate model result with the exact calculation by CFD. And the difference is for resistance, cardboard resistance, is in the range of 1%, 1.5%. For eddy resistance, it was maybe 3%, because it includes also the seaway and so on. But all this is well within the required accuracy for ship design. Okay. There are methods how to develop these surrogate models, and of course you need to have enough variance. So the variants are developed by design of experiments. This is some procedure that may be also known to people working in the probabilistic theory. And out of that, then there are some methods how to develop out of these, the results of these variants, the surrogate models, so alternative algorithms and so on.
Yeah, thanks for the explanation. I just like have one question. You said that in added resistance, the prediction accuracy decreases. Is it because of the number of variables is high? And again, if the number of variables is high, I mean, what do we need, like more samples to train the surrogate for better accuracy?
No, the variants are hundreds of variants, okay? The variants of the vessel. The question is how many parameters also you consider, huh? So in the eddy resistance problem, you have besides the parameters referring to the hull form, you have also the parameters for the seaway. Because the eddy resistance we assume for a certain spectrum, C spectrum, that is described by a certain peak period by and so on. No? So for all these parameters, you generate results. And then out of these results, you develop the surrogate model.
Yeah, okay.
So you need first a direct calculation for all these variants. And this is done upfront. And later when you use that in the optimization, you have just the surrogate model, no? That is telling you for this length, this beam, this draft, the seaway, you have this eddy resistance. So
okay.
Immediately you get the result.
Yeah.
And also we have another question. The question is that you said that the added resistance through the surrogate model has the accuracy or the error of 3% in terms of the accuracy, yeah. But has been also validated based on the ship service data or not?
Okay. I think the essence of this question is something different, no? If we say that between the surrogate model and the direct model, the difference say 3%, no? This doesn't mean that the real eddy resistance is 3% off, okay? This is something different, because even if you do CFD and compare with model experiments or even full scale results, the difference will be in general more, I would say maybe 5% or 6%. But this is a different story. This is something referring to the accuracy of the hydrodynamic modeling, whether you use a CFD, whether you use a potential theory, or an empirical model, no? And how the accuracy to the actual results will be. But here we are talking about the accuracy of the surrogate model to this simplified model of reality. No? Because the hydrodynamic modeling is also some simplified modeling of reality. No?
I also have a question. We know that most of the works in the ship designs are done in calm water condition. And so based on your experience, should we design ships for real sea states or not?
Yes, of course, yeah. It is nowadays, not only say in previous years, the consideration of the performance of the ship in seaway was only a question for naval ships, for maybe offshore vessels. But now you need to consider that also for cargo ship, because of EEDR. In order to estimate the emissions of the ship and compliance with the regulations, you need to know what will be the increase of the resistance in seaway or the loss of speed, what is practically the opposite problem. That means you need to care for this. You cannot ignore it anymore, even for calm water, for merchant ships, merchant ship application. So you need to deal with this problem. And I think for us scientists, it is a good development, no? that now people accept that seakeeping is not only a matter of some special type of ships. Okay. Now when you go to the sizing of the engine, for example, right? The sizing of the engine when I was a student, okay, then we said, okay, we calculate the calm water performance of the ship, and then we had a margin of maybe 25-30% in order to take the engine, the right engine, with margins. Today it is not so. Today it should be easier to do that because 30% for a large ship, taking care of the added resistance, say of a large tanker, it is by far too much. Huh? The margin is so you can estimate this and do a proper sizing of the engine. And of course, now with the new regulations on EEDI, you need also to see the sufficiency of this minimum powering in waves. Maybe some other lecture I will talk about this. That means what is the minimum power for a ship to safely navigate? If you reduce the power because of emission, reduce, then the ship sometime cannot operate safely.
And what about computational time? What about new actually progress about the computational time for especially real sea states? How many scenarios we can consider?
Well, it depends what kind of task you are dealing with. Okay, if you do intensive CFD calculations, this is something, but you can do that separately. It is something that the specialist will be doing up front for many variants. Now, if you go into the design process, we have some procedures, say, for the risk-based design of a ROPAX, when we optimize for the subdivision of the ship, and we do estimate the attained index for hundreds of designs and optimize for this, and also other attributes. Usually, we are working even not on a mainframe computer, at NTUA. Maybe it takes 24 hours to assess something like 400 designs. And the next day you have the results, the NAPA results for 24 designs, 400 designs, and the optimal ones. Something that, in the conventional approach, people take just one day to have the assessment for one ship.
And also I have another question. To calculate the added resistance for following waves, you know, and I know that, for example, we have a lot of challenges to accurately calculate it. Do you have any suggestion for it? Or also I have another question that should we consider the following waves or is, you know, it would be enough to only consider head waves for optimal design of ships?
I think, look, these questions may be at the next lecture.
Yeah, okay.
Hydrodynamics. I don't like to avoid to answer you.
Okay.
But this is very specific. Okay, following waves in sea keeping is a difficult case. Huh? Mm. You know that. It is not only for edit resistance, even for the motion. So it is some situation where you need special care. Depends on the speed of the vessel and the speed of the waves.
Mm.
And whether the take overtakes the ship or not, and so on. So anyway, I think we spent some time with Dr. Liu in our empirical formula to cover this. And we did some thoughts and comparison with results we have from experiments, and they are not that many, I have to say. Mm. But they are good. Maybe look there, and I think there is some guidance for this. Huh? But we talk again.
Yeah, actually now I can see there are questions about hydrodynamics in the chat.
Yes. Yeah.
One question is that in the HOLISHIP project, which method is used for calculating added resistance waves? Is based on semi-empirical method that you said, or any method else?
In the HOLISHIP project, we use alternative procedures. So. We use both CFD, we use the potential theory called new drift developed at NTUA by myself basically, and we have also the empirical method. So because also we like also to compare to each other. So it is a subject that, as I said, we can discuss again. I can see that a lot of hydrodynamic colleagues are also joining this. But maybe we discuss that maybe some other lecture, because I don't avoid these questions, but there are many alternatives, okay, to do that. In HOLISHIP, we had these three approaches, okay?
And
CFD, potential theory, and empirical methods.
And also we have another question. There is any website to get access to actually the software like NAPA, and also be updated about HOLISHIP project?
As I said, you need to have license for this. Huh? Mm. I like to say also the following. There are the basic platforms that we are working with, where the CASES platform, software platform, by Friendship Systems, NAPA, by NAPA OE from Finland, and RCE and CPACs from DLR, Germany. So as far as I know, okay, Friendship Systems has license, educational license and industrial license. You can contact them to get. NAPA the same. The RCE framework is, I think, open source. So you can find on the internet. It will be not easy right away to use it, but I think it is an open source where you can do a lot of things. It is a whole institute in Germany, a research institute of the German aerospace industry that offers this. Now, you need to pay attention. The tools that are doing the actual work in this framework are developed by several partners. And each of these partners has some own property of this. For example, we put hydrodynamic tools into this, or we put some macros into this. Other people put some energy optimization tools into this. So if you look also in the book, you see what kind of tools have been integrated in the platform, the CASES platform. And in fact, the project in one contribution in this book, volume two, by Stefan Harries from Friendship System. He's presenting also our concept about how this marketing of all this should be. Huh? So we are thinking of a certain marketplace, okay, like you go to the market and buy fruits, okay, where many tools are there and you can pick up this and this in connection with certain platform and do your job. Huh? Or even you may also pick up the whole macros for certain things and buy the macros for doing optimization. So this is something that the project is not ready yet because for developing this kind of infrastructure, we need some additional effort. And I think in some next stage of European project, we will be working on this in the next year. So the marketing of HOLISHIP.
Okay. I know that you are so tired now because of so many questions. No,
no, it's okay. I don't know. Yeah. All the questions answered. I don't know.
Yeah. I just, my last question, because I'm really interested in this topic. I'm asking a lot of questions. Actually, what do you think about the future of a HOLISHIP project, and what's the goals you are expected to be reached, and also can we actually fulfill IMO's requirements to such a project or not? What do you think?
Well, look, I personally for myself, because it is also I can tell you maybe 20 years ago I had a dream, huh? Okay,
yeah.
Personally, I'm fully satisfied to see that now, as I said, more than 100 people may be working on this. And I am sure that this will progress because the important thing is to convince the industry to deal with that. And we had in the project many and most representative industry participating. So if the industry is effectively working with all these tools in this way, then I am confident that this goes ahead now. It is, please study the chapters of the book by here by Kongsberg, for example. They optimized an offshore support vessel. And I was extremely happy to see how many tools they used, integrated, and they admitted also that they did all this work now with much less time and they were much more effective. Huh? I think, okay, we did a step, I think significant step. And that is what I told you at the beginning. Because originally I came from hydrodynamics. But even if you are the best hydrodynamicist, you come to a certain point. The question is how to apply that, no? And what is the benefit for the industry out of this. If you don't show them how to use it and teach them, then you need to teach them. You need to teach young people to understand this in order when they go to the industry, apply it. I cannot convince somebody working for 20, 30 years now and he may use Excel and okay, some communication, but also it is not his job to do that. No? The question is whether he's aware of developments. And if you can say, okay, look, at the moment you look at two, three designs, I can offer you 300 designs to compare, if you like, and look at this performance and compare, and take out of them the best on the basis of some criteria that are mathematical. They are rational. It is not just intuitively. This is better or not.
Okay, thank you very much again for very nice presentations and accepting.
I thank you, and I thank all the participants. I can see also many colleagues, Harry Bingham and Yongwan Kim. I think somewhere I have seen these names coming up, and many others. Stienova, Eric Stadt, okay, your professor on ship design. I'm very happy to have given you this lecture, and maybe sometime later I will come with some lecture on hydrodynamics. Thank you very much.